You've heard of The Last of Us, about an apocalyptic zombie world caused by the spread of a mutated fungus. You've probably also heard that it's based off a fungus that exists in the real world, called cordyceps. This is only one of many zombie infections that can raise hell throughout the animal kingdom, and can manipulate their hosts in ways completely unimaginable. I'm gonna introduce you to some of it. I'll go over the classic cordyceps zombie fungus, and show you others that are just as, if not more, sinister. As always, let's get the general information out of the way. As you could probably guess, all the zombie infections on this list are considered parasites. They make their way into the bodies of the host and do with them as they please. But from there, they actually take it a step further, because they're able to manipulate the movements, appearance, behavior, etc. of their hosts as well, thus turning them into zombies, and earning them the title of manipulative parasites. They're parasites, and also manipulative, in order to go about their business in full. Absolutely bone-chilling. Manipulative parasites are found all throughout the natural world, with species of fungi, animals, viruses, bacteria, protozoans. I'm sure you can think of a few in your own world as well. If you're familiar with other videos on this channel, you might remember when I talked about the horsehair worms in the worm episode of What the Fuck Is This? They infect the bodies of crickets and other insects and manipulate them to seek out a body of water. Then they crawl out like little disgusting freaks. They are objectively disgusting. And I'm just gonna say now, if the thought or image of this freaks you out, I'm gonna warn you only once. This video is not for you, because it's only gonna get worse from here. So, now, buckle up. Our first story starts with a tiny carpenter ant. In the early morning hours around 5 to 6 a.m., she has found herself foraging on the forest floor. This is unfortunate. This has made her vulnerable to a cloud of microscopic spores that were just released nearby, and she's completely unaware of them. One of these spores makes contact with her exoskeleton, latches on, and drills to the inside of it, undetected. Her first round of defense is no match for this sly little spore. The ant goes about her business, completely unaware of the new alien inside of her body. For the next several days or weeks, she continues her ant duties, foraging for suitable meals for the colony, maintaining and expanding their nest, attending social events, as if nothing is wrong. And the other ants don't notice, despite their chemical defenses, which typically pick up on sick ants to kick them out of the colony, keep everything running smoothly. No. On the outside, everything is fine, and nobody knows anything. Meanwhile, the infection is spreading. The fungus feeds on the ant's insides and eventually wraps itself around the brain, still keeping it completely intact so it can continue its role as the control center. But somehow, at some point, the fungus gets access and can now manipulate her muscles and thus her movements to its own benefit. This is when shit goes haywire. The ant has been possessed to feel the urge to leave the colony. She wanders around, convulsing, falling down, getting back up again. You would think that she is wasted. But no, you're not even looking at the movements of an ant anymore. You're looking at the movements of a demonic fungus with one goal, to spread. Eventually, the fungus manipulates the ant's body up to the underside of a twig or leaf, about 25 centimeters off the ground. Whatever's left of the ant as an entity is about to be obliterated, with a 0% chance of making it out. The ant bites into the plant material in the infamous death grip, ensuring its body will stay locked to the plant's underside long after the ant's inevitable demise. And then it dies. But still, the fungus is not yet done exploiting the ant's body. It continues eating away until, in a grand finale, the fungus sprouts out of the ant's head, finally making itself known to the outside world. And when the early morning comes again, it releases new spores into the air in search of its next victim. And just like this last ant only weeks before, the next ant will not only be unaware of these tiny spores, but also oblivious that they have found themselves walking through a graveyard of their former colony members, previously infected by the fungus, and now suspended as corpses above the forest floor. This fungus is called Ophiocordyceps unilateralis, or commonly known as the cordyceps fungus. Fossil evidence suggests it's been infecting these ants for at least 48 million years. It's found in tropical areas all over the world, and has a seemingly endless supply of bodies to infect, but not without a challenge, because this insidious cordyceps fungus has its own predators, many of them belonging to their own kind. Yes, more fungus. One such is Niobiomyces coronatus, whose name means crown snowy fungus. It feeds on the tissues of the zombie ant fungus, and covers them in a fuzzy white substance, hence the name crown snowy fungus. Nature is unforgiving, so nature can't heal. So that's the first one on our list. Before we go to the next one, I want to tell you about today's sponsor, Beastlord, the new Linked, an animal-themed strategy mobile game that's all about the laws of the jungle. You can play as tons of different animals to defend your territory, fight for supremacy, and compete with players all around the world. What's really cool is you get to choose your own gameplay path as a lord. There are three distinct classes, each with their own unique playstyle and build it. First up, we got the Collector, perfect for those who love to hoard resources and build up their empire. You'll be a beast of gathering and survival, with a special collector camp that grants you tons of resources. There's also the invader. If you're interested in warfare and thievery, this one is for you. Your armies will be tough, quick to heal, and carry more loot when pillaging. Plus, you'll get an invader camp that gives you an extra march slot with increased attack and defense. And last, we've got developer, all about efficiency and building an empire. You'll get bonuses on food costs, honey production, and even trading perks. Your unique developer camp acts as a market for your allies. But that's not all. Beastlord features over 500 animals that you can collect and train, including some mega beasts like T-Rex and Spinosaurus. You'll be battling it out in a realistic animal world, defending your territory, and competing with players globally. If you want to join the Animal Kingdom and become a Beastlord yourself, click the link in the description and use code BL777 for some sweet bonuses to kickstart your journey. When you log in on the second day, you'll receive a gift, a Supreme Combat Hero, Lion. Melee hero perfect for beginner combat with unique leadership qualities. Check it out, let me know what you think. Thank you, Beastlord, for sponsoring this video. Now, on to the next zombie infection. And for this one, I want to put you in their shoes. This one is called Massospora. It infects cicadas, those insects that emerge in like the billions every year and make those inescapable, deafening calls to find a mate. It's literally the only reason why they come up from the ground. They live in the ground for most of their lives as teenagers or nips. Come up, bang, lay eggs, dead. Different groups of cicadas spend different amounts of time in the ground. Some for a year, others 17 years. A long fucking time, or other time intervals in between. 13. 7. All sorts of shit.
Science!
The ones that we're concerned with for this particular video belong to the genus Magicicada, which emerge from the ground every 13 or 17 years, depending on the species. They get infected by something so deviant. This is where our story begins. Close your eyes. Or not. Whatever you want to do. Our story begins with you, a male cicada nymph. You've lived in the ground since you hatched for over a decade. You, along with the rest of your brood, are getting ready to emerge for the final stage of your life. As you're crawling your way through the soil, a tiny spore latches onto you. So small, you don't even realize that it's there. It had been waiting for you since the day your egg was laid. The spore burrows into your tissues and starts to spread. This invisible seed has suddenly turned into a certified fungal infection. By the time you make it to the sunlight, you are too far gone, and you don't even realize it. You have no idea that this infection is about to rip your abdomen off and turn you bisexual.
No.
That's right, bitches. This is a bisexual zombie fungus. Let me explain. These cicadas have a very specific mating ritual. And the females have these very intricately timed dances. They flick their wings around to indicate to males that they're ready to mate. Infected males will respond to these dances and infect healthy females, as you would expect. Infected females will also attract healthy males with the mating dances and affect them that way, as you would expect. But on top of all of that, somehow, the fungus goes a bit further with the males and manipulates their movements to mimic the females' dances perfectly, attracting healthy males to mate, thus passing the infection through a third, unexpected avenue. Insidious business, I know. And this means the infection is a step more complex. This is a bisexual, sexually transmitted zombie fungus. Keep in mind that at some point, their abdomen was ripped off. Not open, but off, to expose this white fungal pluck, like the tip of a godforsaken eraser. At this point, the cicada should be dead. They're literally ripped in half. But the fungus keeps them barely alive to spread their seed and manipulate them in any which way they want to. You're probably thinking, this sounds horrible. What a nightmare to imagine being in the shoes of these cicadas. And no need to fret, because there's another element to this infection to tell you about. Drugs. As the infection is spreading in this stage, it releases a variety of substances into the cicada's body, depending on the species. For some, cathinone and amphetamine. For others, psilocybin, a classic case of magic mushrooms. They don't know which way is up, and it probably feels great. This means this is a bisexual, drug-crazed, sexually transmitted zombie fungus. I think I've painted quite a vivid picture of this infection. The reality is, it really only affects like 5 to 10% of a group, which, yes, in like millions or billions of individuals, that's a lot infected, but 5 to 10% nonetheless. They are mere pieces of what they used to be. So, needless to say, infected cicadas are sterile. This is where stage 2 of the infection comes into play, how it spreads to the next generation. Eventually, the infection produces the next stage of spores, which are not meant to be passed between adult mating cicadas, but instead fall to the ground and passively sink into the soil. The healthy cicadas that had no part in the drug-induced orgy lay their eggs, as planned, and die, as planned, leaving the next generation to continue on. They hatch, return to the soil as nymphs, just like their ancestors, with no idea that those spores are waiting and ready to infect this new generation when they prepare to emerge 13 or 17 years from now. All right, How are we feeling? Maybe a few things. Maybe horrified by the brutal yet creative shackles of population control done by Mother Nature. Maybe amazed as well. Probably a mix of both. I have a few more to introduce you to as kind of honorable mentions. The fungus ones are my personal favorites. Now, these ones are examples of other manipulative parasites that I mentioned at the beginning of this video. Maybe that will serve as an inspiration for part two of this video, if that's something you sick freaks are interested in seeing. So, let's start off with this. Life Science calls them the disco zombie snails. Looks pretty cool on the outside, and is just horrific on the inside. Obviously, the snail's eye stalks don't usually look like this. This is the result of the green-banded brood sac, a parasitic flatworm with a heinous objective. This story starts in the digestive tract of a bird. Here lies the adult form of this parasite, which lays eggs, so to be released within the bird's shit, in hopes that they will be ingested by a snail. That's their business.
We listen and we don't judge.
Once inside a snail, the eggs hatch into a larval stage called a sporocyst. The sporocyst then makes its way to the snail's eye stalks, where it forms a sac-like structure filled with larvae, known as a brood sac. This is when the disco begins. The brood sac pulsates with bright colors, usually green and brown bands, hence the name green-banded brood sac. These make the snail's eye stalk resemble a caterpillar, or a grub, i.e. a delicious meal to none other than a bird. This zombie brood sac will also manipulate the behaviors of the snail, dragging them to higher ground to serve them on a platter. The bird pecks at the infected eye stalk, mistaking it for prey, and ingests the parasitic larvae, which then make their way through the digestive tract and turn into adults, so the process can begin again. The last one on our list is a bit different. So far, we've talked about the parasites that turn invertebrates into zombies. This next one is a vertebrate, none other than a rat. Yes, zombie rats. The parasite in question is called Toxoplasma gondii. It's a type of single-celled organism called a protozoa. Despite their appearance, protozoans are not bacteria. Their single cell is a eukaryotic cell, which are the kinds of cells we have, other animals have, and plants and fungi have. It just so happens that there are three categories that you can put every form of life on Earth into. They're called domains. It's bacteria, archaea, and eukaryota. Bacteria and archaea are made of prokaryotic cells, which are super simple cells. Eukaryota are made of eukaryotic cells, which are super complex cells. You probably remember this from sixth grade bio, all the different organelles. The mitochondria is the powerhouse of the cell. That is a eukaryotic cell. Plants, fungi, animals have it, and also protozoans. Protozoans are single, free-living eukaryotic cells, and sometimes they are heinous. This story starts in the intestines of a cat. Protozoan reproduces, releasing infectious seeds into the cat's shit. Somehow, in some fashion, those seeds get ingested by a grazing rat and start to form tissue cysts, especially in the rat's brain. These alter the behavior of the rat, making them less fearful of cats. Also, rats have a natural aversion to cat urine. They smell cat pee and stay away. This parasite fucks all of that up. Cat piss? No problem to the rat. Matter of fact, they're interested, which obviously makes them much more likely to be eaten by a cat. So the process can begin again. You might have heard of this one before because the infection is commonly known as toxoplasmosis, because it can infect other rodents and pretty much all other mammals, possibly other animals as well, including humans. But do not fret. This does not mean your cat is a threat to you. As long as your cats aren't eating infected rodents, they're fine. They should be inside anyway, because they're killing all the birds. Toxoplasmosis is one of those infections you can get from eating undercooked meat or drinking water from a questionable water source. So, this should not be life-altering information. Everything is business as usual. And on that note, I hope you liked this video. If you did, be sure to subscribe so you don't miss the next episode of the history of life on Earth that we know of. Thank you, Beastlord, for sponsoring this video. Check out the sweet deal in the link in the description. Check out my Patreon for behind-the-scenes updates on our Discord server. And for now, stay curious. The world has a lot for us to learn. See ya! And that means this is a bisexual drug... Fuck. Ow.